להיפתח לשינוי זה אפשרי. תוכנית שבועית בימי שלישי, 11 עד 12, עם אורלי ברקימה. אני מזמינה אתכם להיות איתי ועם אורחות ואורחים שעשו שינויים משמעותיים בחיים שלהם, שסיפורים שלהם יכולים לתת לנו השראה וכלים לדרך האישית שלנו, למסע הפרטי שלנו. וביחד, משבוע לשבוע, אנחנו נבנה פסיפס אנושי מיוחד במינו, שיעזור לכולנו להתפתח ולצמוח בחיים שלנו. להיפתח לשינוי זה אפשרי. מורלי ברקימה. בוקר טוב, יום שלישי, להיפתח לשינוי זה אפשרי. אנחנו כאן בתוכנית שמביאה סיפורי השראה של נשים, של גברים שעשו שינויים בחיים שלהם. ולמה השראה? כי אני מאמינה שדרך סיפורים ודרך השראה אנחנו יכולים ללמוד לקחת השראה לחיים שלנו, ואולי ככה גם על הדרך לקחת איזה כלי או שתיים. היום יש לי אורחת מאוד מאוד מיוחדת שהגיעה אלינו מהודו. שמה, ואני רוצה לדייק, גשם קלסנג וואנגמו, שהיא בעצם שליחה פה שבאה דרך אגודת ידידי הדרמה, והם מעבירים בארץ סדנאות, קורסים בנושא של בודהיזם טיבטי. אני תכף אציג אותה בעברית, אני אגיד כמה מילים באנגלית, והשיחה תתנהל בעברית ובאנגלית, כשמדי פעם אני אשאל אותה שאלה, ואני אתרגם או אתמצת את התשובה שלה. Good morning.
Good morning.
Geshe Kelsang Wangmo.
Yes.
I'm improving.
Yes, much better.
It will get better in the end. And thank you very much for coming here to the show. I will conduct this show in English and Hebrew.
Okay.
Because the viewers are Israeli.
Right.
And I will ask you in English, you will repeat in English, and I will a little bit translate what you are saying.
Okay.
I hope my English is good enough for it, for this. it's a little bit of a challenge, okay. But you know, we are doing our best. This is all we can.
Okay.
So I will speak and introduce you in Hebrew.
Sure.
And then we will talk a little. Okay.
Sounds good.
אז אני רוצה להציג לכם את קלסנג.
Yes.
קלסנג. Okay. קלסנג. היא באה לארץ במיוחד כדי ללמד אותנו איך להיות מאושרים. העצות והטיפים שלה לקוחות ישר מספר חדש שיצא בעברית ממש ממש לאחרונה, שנקרא למלא את הלב בחמלה. זה ספר שכתב בן אדם שעבד מאוד מאוד צמוד, דוקטור ג'פרי הופקינס, עם הדלאי למה, הסתובב איתו ברחבי העולם, ובעצם יש פה תמצות של שיעורים שהדלאי למה נתן, בעיקר סביב הנושא הזה של חמלה, כשהמטרה, כתוב פה, מדריך ליצירת שלווה פנימית ועולם מאושר יותר. וקלסנג מגיעה לארץ. It's not your first time, right?
Here in Israel?
In Israel.
No, it's my fourth time.
Yeah, we will talk about that. היא באה במיוחד כדי להעביר פה סדנאות וקורסים, כמו שאמרתי, ובעיקר לדבר על הנושא של חמלה ואיך למלא את הלב בחמלה, כדרך לעזור לעצמנו. להיות קצת יותר מאושרים ויותר מסופקים בחיים שלנו. אבל היא לא סתם נזירה, כמו שאתם רואים, היא נזירה בודהיסטית. התואר שלה הוא תואר גשה. גשה הוא תואר מאוד מאוד גבוה, אולי הכי גבוה בבודהיזם הטיבטי. היא למדה 17 שנה במכון לדיאלקטיקה בודהיסטית בדרמסלה שבהודו. בעידודו של כבוד הדלאי למה בעצמו, יש להם קשר מיוחד ואני תספר על זה בהמשך. יש לה גם סיפור חיים יוצא דופן, כי היא נולדה בכלל בגרמניה, יצאה לטייל בעולם. בין היתר, כפי ששמעתם, היא הגיעה גם לארץ, היא התנדבה פה בקיבוץ, עבדה בפיצריה בתל אביב, בהמשך היא המשיכה למזרח הרחוק, הגיעה להודו, ושם נחשפה ונשבטה בקסמי הבודהיזם הטיבטי. התחילה להעמיק בנושא, ללמוד אותו, ללמוד את השפה הטיבטית, היא דוברת טיבטית. ותוך שנתיים היא בחרה להפוך לנזירה. גם על ההחלטה הזאת, אנחנו פה בתוכנית שעוסקת בשינויים בחיים, אז זה מאוד מעניין ככה איך בן אדם מהמערב עושה כזה סוויש בחיים שלו, ומעניין לראות מה עזר לה ומה תמך בה לעשות את זה. הלימודים האלה הם לימודים, כמו שאמרתי, מאוד מאוד נחשבים וגבוהים, הם נחשבים, הם מקבילים לדוקטור פילוסופיה בתרבות המערבית, ולמעשה היא אישה פורצת דרך, כי האישה הראשונה שזכתה לתואר הזה. היום היא גרה בהודו, ומזה מספר שנים היא מלמדת את הפילוסופיה הבודהיסטית, גם לסטודנטים מערביים, היא מגיעה למערב, היא מלמדת בארצות הברית וגם בארץ. As good morning, Kelsang, and thank you again. I asked you before, it's not your first time here in Israel, right? Mm-hmm. You were here as a young girl?
Mm-hmm. After high school, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience here in Israel?
Well, the first time I came, just after high school, I decided to take some time off before joining university. And so somewhere I saw a poster, I think, something about Israel, and just the idea, or maybe I, you know, traveled to Israel and I heard about the kibbutz. I thought that was a good idea to get to know people, get to work, get to know the country better. And so I chose, there was like a book at the time, you could choose the different kibbutzim, and I chose Alumot in the north.
Okay.
And so I basically
was... Which is also a special place. It's not a usual kibbutz because they do that there.
The health care
and the cleaning and
Not at the time, no. I think it was just... that time it was just a small kibbutz. And I liked the idea of like a small kibbutz. So it'd be easier to get to know people. And it's just a little bit more... it's not as anonymous as it would be like in a big one. And the area sounded beautiful, so that's why I chose it. And I first went to Egypt for a month. A friend of mine was traveling with me. And then I went on my own. I went to the kibbutz and stayed there for 3 months. Yeah.
And, you know, it's not unusual, the decision for, I don't know, an 18-year-old. Mm. You just finished high school. Usually here, you know, in Israel, when the children, they go at 18, they go to the army for two or three years. And then they go to the big trip, you know, after the army to release themselves from all this pressure.
Yeah.
And in Europe, I think most of the young women and men, they go to college.
They do, yeah, most of them. I mean,
did you plan like a big trip, or you said, no, I just want to taste something before the college?
Yeah, I thought, well, I haven't got any experience of anything but Germany. I mean, I've been with my parents to different places, but just small vacations. And I thought, that can't be it. I wanted to see something more. And also, I couldn't really decide what to study. I had some ideas, but I couldn't really decide on one topic. And so I thought, well, if I go travel a little bit, it probably gives me an idea what I want to do with my life. And the choice was Israel. And I didn't plan. I was thinking, okay, so I go to Israel, spend some time there, and I see how it goes, and maybe I get time to travel around the area a little bit more. But I had no plans. I mean, everything kind of developed once I was here, once I met different people, and they told me about different places, and then I decided to go.
Okay. אז בקצרה, היא הגיעה לפה אחרי לימודי תיכון, החליטה לחוות חוויה של קיבוץ, עבדה בקיבוץ אלומות, במשך 3 חודשים. לא היה לה תוכנית גדולה מיוחדת לנסוע ולטייל בעולם, היא פשוט רצתה לעשות איזושהי טעימה קצרה מחול, לפני שהיא חוזרת ומחליטה מה היא הולכת ללמוד בגרמניה באוניברסיטה. והדברים איכשהו התגלגלו. זה ככה פחות או יותר התמצות של מה שהיא אמרה. So as a German child, when you were little, you know, when we are 4 or 5 years old, and we have like a birthday cake, and there are candles, and we close our eyes, you know, and we wish, I wish I would do something. What were your wishes? Did you plan this kind of adventurous life or different life, or you had something else in your mind?
No, not at all. I don't remember what I wished. Probably things like bicycles and dolls, and I don't know what I wished for in that moment. No, there was nothing extraordinary. I think I just had a normal life, just, you know, growing up and going to school and being with my sister and my friends, and that's it. No, I didn't think in that direction. I wasn't even religiously inclined, I mean, in any sense. Of course, I was raised in a Catholic kind of setting, but when I was little, there was a little bit of like interest, but not very much. And then once I started, you know, becoming a teenager, I was like, I was not interested in religion at all. So yeah, nothing out of the ordinary, nothing.
And what did you want to be when you were, you know, bigger? You had something in your mind?
I mean, I wanted to become a doctor when I was little, but that was like, I had no idea what that meant. You know, I had a little kind of medical case, like a toy, and that I thought was fascinating, and my family was supportive of the idea, so they kind of fostered that. But then when I grew older, I wasn't sure anymore, and psychology started really interesting me. I thought psychology was something interesting. And I was just kind of, yeah, looking around. A teacher was also something I thought was nice, to be a teacher, maybe for mentally challenged children, or I just couldn't. It was like every year I had a different idea.
Yeah, you know, and when you're a teenager, you change your mind.
All the time.
Yeah, most of the time. Like for me, when I was a young girl, I wanted to be a journalist, to be a big journalist and travel the world and do important missions, and they have, you know. I was a journalist.
I became a journalist.
I have a 6-year-old. I have a 19-year-old son. Mm-hmm. He's in the army now, 15, and I have a 6.5-year-old. And when you ask him now, what do you want to be when you grow up? I want to be Superman.
Oh wow.
Well, it's nice how it will come true, you know. So tell me, what did your family had to say about you going, you know, to travel the world and to be on your own at the age of 18?
I mean, they were very worried, really. I mean, well, the idea wasn't that I was going to stay away for that long. So then it was not as bad because I thought, okay, I'm going to go to Israel. They know where I am. I was staying in Tel Aviv for a while with a colleague of my mom. Like, his parents live in Tel Aviv, they're Israeli. So I lived with them for a while, they could always call. Then when I started traveling to other countries, and actually I heard about India, Asia, like, you know, the Israelis, other travelers, they would tell me. And I really wanted to go there. And then when I decided to go, my parents got worried, of course. They did come and visit sometimes. I met them in Indonesia. So they came to visit me there. They also later came to India, so they did kind of follow my travels, if you like, but they were always concerned, of course.
Yeah, parents, you know.
Yeah, naturally, yeah.
So you say your life, סליחה, אני קצת אתרגם, היא אומרת שהיא לא תכננה במיוחד לעשות איזשהו טיול ארוך במיוחד, או לנסוע לכל מיני מקומות אקזוטיים. בהתחלה היא חשבה רק על ישראל, ולאט לאט התחילה לשמוע שאנשים פה מדברים על המזרח הרחוק, וזה סקרן אותה. המשפחה שלה, כשהיא ידעה שהיא בישראל, קצת פחות דאגה, אבל כשהיא שמעה שהיא הולכת לטייל במזרח, דאגה לה קצת יותר, וההורים שלה אפילו באו לבקר אותה באינדונזיה ובעוד כל מיני מקומות בטיול שלה, אבל עדיין הם היו מודאגים ודאגו לה. So when you know you look at your life back now, from where you are now, and you think about your life, you think it was a choice of yours, or it's like a karma that this was your destiny, this is what meant to be?
I think it's a mixture of both. I mean, certain things happened to me that I would say is the result of past action, so in that sense the result of karma, because karma just means action, so result, you know, resulting actions. But I've also had choices. I would, you know, do I do this, do I do something else? There were things open to me either direction, and then I made a choice. So it was kind of a
mixture,
yes. I mean, certain things just happened. I didn't have, you know, like a million choices, but I had quite a few, and I made some, yeah, so.
It's a mixture of both. שאלת אותה אם זה, אם החיים שלה כפי שהם התגלגלו, מבחינתה זה היה איזשהו גורל, איזושהי קרמה שבעצם היא קרתה לה, או שהיא עשתה את הבחירות האלה בעצמה, והיא אומרת שזה היה סוג של שילוב בין השניים, בין בחירות שהיא עשתה פה ושם, לבין אולי משהו שהיא באה להשלים פה מגלגולים קודמים. So tell me, the when you came to India and Dharamsala, What pulled you? What interested you in the Buddhism? And the Buddhism also is not, it's a specific Buddhism. It's the Tibetan Buddhism, right?
Right, yes, yes.
What pulled you there?
I mean, nothing specific to Dharamsala. It was not that I thought, oh my God, I'm going to go and study Buddhism in Dharamsala. Not at all. I wasn't interested in Buddhism, actually. I was interested in different religions. I when I was here, I talked to people about Judaism. I talked with people about, you know, the different kind of faith in terms of Christianity, the different kind of sections of Christianity. And in India, I talked with people about Hinduism. I was just interested, but not in any way kind of personally, more than just interest. And when I came to Dharamsala, it's just something about the atmosphere there. I mean, now I think it's because people like the Dalai Lama live there. There's some incredibly, what you would call in Tibetan, like lamas. Spiritual being, highly evolved spiritual beings who've really developed their mind in a very drastic way, and it influences the whole area. It seems very peaceful.
It's in the energy.
Yeah, the energy of the place is just different. I mean, it's like a place where people spend a lot of time meditating. It is also a very touristy place, but nonetheless, in the areas around, there's a lot of meditators, and it has a very peaceful kind of atmosphere. And I just like that. I came there and I felt at home right away. It's like a feeling of, wow, this is like, I've almost come home. And I didn't, I only wanted to stay for 2 weeks. That was my last stop, really, on my trip, right? I was going to go home and start university. It was all kind of clearly laid out in my mind. And then I got there. I met two Israeli girls that I took a room with. We took, well, different rooms, but we basically kind of spent a lot of time together. And they were also interested in yoga and meditation. It wasn't even particularly Buddhism I was interested in, but there's like a lot of courses. They offer yoga, they offer like meditation courses, and some are Buddhist, some are not Buddhist. And I wanted to learn about meditation, meditation and yoga. So I did a yoga course first, and the yoga teacher at the time introduced some meditative techniques, and that's when my interest grew in this kind of.
Before you never did meditation?
No, never, never.
It wasn't part of your...
No, not that I disliked it, I just wasn't interested in any way.
You weren't aware.
I wasn't aware of it, yeah. I didn't even know what it meant. I could say the word and had some kind of rough idea, but yeah, I didn't know. So, and then I did this, another course on Buddhism itself, and that really interested me. I just felt... And that's just a personal thing. It's not for everyone. I mean, it's just a personal decision. But I found a lot of answers within Buddhism, a lot of questions that I wasn't even aware I had, but they kind of, the question became more obvious and the answer came. But not, I mean, it was not like I liked it right from the beginning. I had lots of other doubts. I mean, past and future lives, karma, that didn't really make that much sense to me. And I had a lot of
and
questions.
And you weren't in any, it wasn't, you know, sometimes people, when I wrote the book, I found out when I asked why people change their lives. And you know, I found that there are two big motives, engines.
Okay.
One of the big ones is that people, when they hurt, you know, when they suffer, when they get spanks from life.
Yes, yes.
When they get diseases, or they get fired, or they get divorced, or they get... Something from outside,
okay.
You know, gives them a hit and they suffer and they say, okay, I don't want to suffer anymore. I'm changing my life.
Okay.
They come to a threshold. And the other engine, there is the inside engine. The engine that you know, that you do well in your life, you're in your comfort zone, you have a family, you have a job, it's okay. But there is a burning, a yearning, if you want, from inside that said, that's it, that's life. I want more,
right,
I want more excitement, I want more, to bring more of myself, you know. And I found, when I talk to people, that the two engines, sometimes it's very obvious, you know, that this engine, you know, my father died, I was in mourning, I couldn't deal with it, and this was the time that I changed my life, something like that.
Yeah.
And others, but sometimes it's also mixed, you know, when the engines, you get the blow and then something inside or something inside and then something from the outside makes you even more wanting to change your life. How is it for you?
I'm trying to think, while you're speaking, I'm trying to think, what was my situation. Well, there wasn't anything dramatic that happened. Not at all. I mean, it's not like a
You didn't have a childhood, you know, that you suffered as a child and you wanted to run away from home.
No, actually, I mean, of course I had my problems growing up as a teenager, you know, the usual peer pressure and the usual stuff, but nothing extraordinary, traumatic or anyway. I mean, my parents, very, very kind, were very kind then, very understanding, very supportive. So I had nothing to complain about. But I guess it was more the second case, though not to that extent. But I remember thinking after high school, that can't be it, right? It's like, okay, go to university, get married, get that, and that's it. So it wasn't really like a deeper meaning in life as such, but like, I want to see more of the world.
It's like you were very young. Usually people with that engine,
right,
they're in their late 30s, 40s, right, you know, yes, when yes. they've done and they got into a zone that they said, that's it. But right. you were very young then.
Well, my thinking at that time was definitely very immature, not like a person who has so much life experience, but it was this kind of like, the world is so big, there must be more I can get out of this world than just staying in this one place. And the thing was also where I come from, it's a small place, it was always the same people, the same neighbors, the people I grew up with. So it wasn't really like I went to the city and that city and, mm-hmm. you know, like lots of different kind of new ideas and people. So, and that was just this urge, I want to see something more of the world, but then I come back. Mm-hmm. Right, I'll return back and I do everything what other people do, but then I have a better sense, I can make decisions in a better way. And it grew also over time. I mean, it wasn't like I was, you know, out of high school and had exactly that in mind. My memory is hazy of this now, but the point is, that was kind of what drove me. And honestly, when I first came to Dharamsala and I saw the first Buddhist monk, a Western Buddhist monk, I thought, how embarrassing. Why would you like to dress like a Tibetan? I have no idea what it meant. And this is why it's great nowadays when someone looks at me and goes, I totally remember. I remember what it felt to me like. Anyway, so that was my attitude. I didn't like kind of organized religion. I mean, not that I disliked it, great, but I was suspicious of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, with Buddhism, it was like a very, very slow process that I decided to really get into it. First, I was just wanted to know more, slowly. In the beginning, I never thought of becoming a nun. I thought that was like bizarre, kind of strange.
Yeah, that was my next question. Just let me...
translate.
It was lots of stuff, but I will say in short. היא הגיעה לדרמסלה, היא פגשה שם שתי בנות ישראליות דווקא, שלמדו יוגה וקצת מדיטציות, והיא חברה אליהם, והיא התחילה לחוות ולהתנסות, לפני כן היא מעולם לא ניסתה, וזה התחיל לעניין אותה. ואז היא עשתה איזשהו קורס על בודהיזם, ושם היא אומרת, היא הרגישה בבית, שבכלל בדרמסלה האנרגיה, בגלל שהרבה למות, הרבה אנשים מכובדים בתרבות הטיבטית, למות וגשב והדלאי למה עצמו גר שם, הייתה מין אווירה, הייתה מין אטמוספירה, אנרגיה במקום הזה, שגרמה לה להרגיש בבית. אבל לא היו לה איזה שהן כוונות מיוחדות, לא כילדה ולא כנערה או אישה בת 18, להפוך לנזירה או להיות בודהיסטית בהתחלה, זה ממש לא הייתה כוונה, הדברים פשוט איכשהו לאט לאט התגלגלו. So, you were there for 2 years, and then you decided to become a nun?
Yes, it was like, not in Dharamsala, I was only about 9 months.
Okay.
I'd arrived in Dharamsala and I did, you know,
you met the Dalai Lama there?
Yeah, I met him there. Like, we had like a public audience. They don't really have those now anymore, but it was at that time you could kind of go up to him, shake his hand, and then the next person would come. It was a very quick encounter. And I just thought, what a lovely, kind kind of, you know, person, but nothing more than that at the time. And I just heard about this course in Buddhism. It was about a month. First, it was like I was planning to stay for 2 weeks. Then I decided to stay longer just because I liked it so much and the atmosphere was so special. And then slowly, after a month or two, I did the first course. And that's when I slowly got more into it. And then there's a meditation center in Dharamsala called Tushita.
Mm-hmm.
So I went there, I did a course there. And slowly the idea grew, I want to do this my whole life. I want to study this in university. Okay, forget about becoming a doctor now. I wanted to study it in university. And then that was like, okay, that's going to be how many years? Realistically, 4 or 5 years. And then what? Right? And what can I do with this? And then slowly, again, maybe something, okay, afterwards I may become a Buddhist kind of scholar or, you know, research it more, or I don't know, I had kind of very hazy ideas. And one day I thought, well, what about this whole monks and nuns business? People become monks and nuns. So how about me? Maybe I, you know, and for the first time the thought came. And then the next moment I was like, oh, no. What am I thinking, right? I mean, me and nun, I couldn't. And it was like a slow kind of a seed growing within, and then again, and slowly the thought became a little stronger, but it still seems so bizarre because it's like your whole life, basically. And
it's a big decision.
It's a big decision, right? I mean, I guess it's a little bit like getting married. I mean, in a way, yeah. Like my whole life with one person, you always know you can get divorced, right?
Yeah.
But you don't make the decision in the back, like, I can always get divorced, so let's try it. It's really, you make, the point is you do it for your whole life.
It's so a commitment.
It's a commitment. So as a nun, I knew I can always return my vows. So that is a possibility, but I wanted to be able to do it my whole life. And especially because I'd only finished high school. So what if after 15 years I was going to decide, change my mind, I'm not a nun anymore, what am I going to do? So I had to be realistic about the future too. But anyway,
I want to understand the experience. You write, you see it, you take a paper and you write, why to become a nun, why not to become a nun? How is that decision made?
I mean, not literally took a paper.
From the head?
But yes, I was going back and forth. What would it be, an advantage or not? And nothing was forcing me. But I had a lot of time because I was in Dharamsala, I was with my friends, I was doing a lot of, Buddhism, the people I was with, they were also interested in Buddhism, so we were discussing it. So I spent a lot of time thinking about it, like, should I not? And my interest also grew stronger. I mean, I was reading different books, and I thought they were so interesting, and they gave me so many answers. On top of that, I felt I was getting happier. I mean, some of the worries I had before, some of the doubts, they slowly faded away. So there was more peace of mind. I just felt happier, I guess. So that showed me this is something that, for me personally, works well. And anyway, so I also met other monks and nuns. And so I asked them, what is the difficulties? You know, what are the difficulties? What are the challenges? Did you ever regret doing it? Would you do it differently nowadays? And just wanted to see, what are all the difficulties? And there's also a time, you know, like when you get married, what is it, the second year or the third year that people...
Doubts. Yeah.
Doubts, exactly. So I said, what is your year? And it's kind of interesting, they all said around 2 years. And what did you do? How did you overcome it? Anyway, so I tried to kind of overcome all my doubts. And I told my parents at some point, or I called my mom and dad, and I said, you know, I want to become a nun.
Hello, mom, dad.
Well, it was not bad. But there was a time when making a phone call was really expensive.
Okay.
It was really expensive. You had 3 minutes, so I didn't have much time to tell my mom, I want to become a nun. And she's like, stop. Do not move. I'm coming. So do not do anything rushed. And she actually thought I had joined a cult. Because at that time, I mean, people knew about the Dalai Lama, of course, to some extent, but not as much as people do nowadays. And they don't know so much, they didn't know much about the Tibetans, about Buddhism. So, you know, people go to India. The first thing that comes to mind, if you join some kind of spiritual kind of system, well, it's a cult. Anyway, so my mom was like, don't give away your money, I'll come. She thought I was going to be brainwashed into something. Anyway, so then she actually came, and she came to visit. And at that time, I'd gone to Nepal, Kathmandu. There's a monastery called Kopan, which is connected to Tushita. It's the same kind of lama who founded it. And I did a course there. And so she came to visit me.
At Kathmandu,
she came to visit. And she got to see that what I was actually doing was not some kind of cult. I had all the freedom in the world. There were nice and friendly people that she could talk to. There were Germans, she could speak to in German, so that was easier for her. But she said, okay, if you really want to become a nun, and at that time it was stronger and stronger, and I was thinking, okay, I really want to do this. And she said, you have to come home with me for 3 months. And if you then still want to do it, you know, you get our blessing. I mean, it's kind of like an idea. You don't want to do it against the wish of your parents. So it's usually recommended to talk to your parents about it and ask them to give their permission. And so I wanted that very badly. And so my mom said, okay, if you come home with us and you still want to do it, right?
That's fair. Yeah.
And I mean, sure, I could have been...
To pull you out of this old environment and to see if you still want it so much.
Yeah.
It sounds fair to me.
Right, it sounds like a good idea. Anyway, so then I said I agreed, we went home, and after 3 months I still wanted to be a nun. I returned to Dharamsala and I took ordination. Yeah. So that was about 9 months after.
The whole process took 9 months?
Yeah, I would say around 9 months it took.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will translate a little.
Sure.
I forget I have to translate because it's very interesting. אז בקצרה שאלתי אותה לגבי הנזירות ואיך היא בחרה להיות נזירה ואם היא חשבה על זה קודם. והיא אמרה שזה היה מאוד 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 רחוק מעולמה והיא כלל לא חשבה על להיות בכלל נזירה. ואפילו כשהיא ראתה את הנזירים עם הגלימות בהתחלה, הסתכלה על זה בצורה קצת מוזרה והקמה את הפרצוף. ועד היום שהיא רואה אנשים מסתכלים עליה לבושה ככה ומעקמים, היא זוכרת את אותה תחושה של אז. אבל לאט לאט ככל שהיא התקדמה בלימודים של הבודהיזם והעמיקה, והתחילה לדבר עם נזירים ונזירות שהיו בסביבה שלה, ואנשים שהיא חיה איתם והכירה, פתאום הזרע הזה, המחשבה הזאת נשתלה במוחה, ולאט לאט גם הלכה וגדלה, ובאיזשהו שלב היא החליטה שהיא רוצה, ואז היא התקשרה לאימא שלה. השיחות היו מאוד יקרות, היא אומרת, אז היה שיחה מאוד קצרה, ואמרה לאימא, אני החלטתי להיות נזירה, ואימא שלה אמרה לה, תעצרי הכל, אני באה, אל תעשי שום דבר. היא חשבה שהיא מצטרפת לאיזה קאט ומאוד מאוד הייתה מודאגת. ואז היא באה לקטמנדו, שם היא הייתה באיזה מנזר ככה, כדי לחוות, כדי לראות מה הילדה עוברת, והיא הציעה לסוג של עסקה ואמרה לה, אוקיי, אני רואה שזה לא משהו כל כך נורא ושזה משהו שטוב לבוא. ולאט לאט היא גם אומרת בעצמה שהיא התחילה להרגיש יותר טוב, והספקות נעלמו, והרבה תשובות לשאלות שהיו לה היא פתאום קיבלה, והרגישה הרבה יותר שלווה עם עצמה. ואימא שלה ראתה שטוב לה, אבל עדיין רצתה שהיא תקבל החלטה ממקום נקי, ולכן הציעה לה לנסוע לגרמניה למשך 3 חודשים, ואם לאחר מכן היא עדיין תרצה להיות נזירה, אז היא תיתן לה את ברכתה, ההורים שלה ייתנו את ברכתה, וזה בפועל מה שקרה. You know, when I think about it, of this life as a nun, is there, you know, a mission that you are set to do? It's something that is something beyond you, or you say, you know, I'm just Kalsang, the small one, I wanted to be a happy life for myself.
I mean, a mission like a mission to change the world, definitely not, because I mean that's totally impossible to change the world. But the idea is that to make changes, I mean, to look around and see the world, there's a lot of suffering. I mean, people have so many problems and difficulties. And even when they're comfortable at some point, you know, anything can happen anytime. So in order to bring about some changes, the idea is to change within. Mm-hmm. And that our problems and difficulties also come from within, from our own, state of mind, from our own, you know, anger, aggressiveness, resentment, attachment to certain things, can't be without that, don't want to be with this. And it actually all comes from within. So understanding that if I want to change anything, I need to change first myself. So in that sense, it's a kind of mission, and it's the most difficult thing.
That's what Gandhi said, be the change that you want to see in the world.
Exactly, yes, exactly. So, I mean, this is also what the entire book is about, by the Dalai Lama. Basically talking about if we really want to be happy, we need to be kinder, we need to be more compassionate, control anger and hatred and resentment, because in the end it harms us much more than anyone else. So, and it's difficult. It's not easy. It's one of the most difficult things. I mean, it's hard enough to exercise the body.
Yeah.
But to exercise the mind and change that, it's a great challenge.
Because it's, you know, our mind works on automatic
habits. Exactly, yes.
And the automatics takes us to the negative, to the criticism, to the judgment.
Right, right.
This is the automatic. To be positive, it's a work.
Yes, yes. No,
I always tell
the
people when I teach, you know, that is the work.
Right, right.
Basically.
No, absolutely, absolutely. And the thing is, I mean, actually a lot of spiritual systems, a lot of religions tell us be kind, compassionate and so forth. But what I found, me personally, really suited me was the Buddhist technique of showing you how to do it.
Okay, I mean, so this is the time that I want you to give us some tips. You know, you came here to teach happiness. Mm-hmm. We all want to be happier.
Right, right. I mean, the idea is, again, happiness comes from within. I mean, the external environment does play a role, but like, let's say you're really, really sick and everything goes wrong, if you're internally happy and peaceful, well then it doesn't matter what the external circumstances are. Whereas on the other hand, if everything works perfect, everything is well around you, you know, your friends are loving and kind, but you're not happy within, again, the external is just secondary. So the idea is to generate this, you know, more internal kind of happiness, and then through states of mind such as love, compassion, and understanding that the opposite of those states of mind, I mean, we all have love and compassion to some degree, and we show it all the time, but it's very partial and temporary. At times it's there, but then very strong anger and resentment arise. So Buddhism is more about identifying these negative states of mind and understanding that they're very harmful.
What you're saying, that even, you know, evil person, a murderer, someone who is hitting his wife and kids and abusing them, has this compassion or love inside of him, but it's dormant, it's what?
Yeah, I mean, it could very much lie dormant. But I mean, I'm sure there's a situation when that person, I mean, I know it's totally bizarre, but
because
just sees a
he
sick...
He says in the book, you know, and I marked it because, you know, when I read it, it's striking me. And I know Jesus said, turn the other cheek, and I know these ideas, but he says here, you know, that you have to love your enemy. And this is very, very hard thing to do. Someone who is hurting me. I'm not talking, you know, now politics.
No.
I'm talking about people.
Just everyday life kind
everyday
of encounters.
Everyday life. Yeah. You know, I met women who were abused, who were sexually abused by their father. And okay. You have to love him, and you have to be compassionate for him. It's daring.
Well, the thing is, like, have to, it sounds like just do it, which we cannot do. I mean, it's not saying, but it's just saying your anger and resentment hurt you much more.
Yeah.
It's like really understanding that the hatred and the hurt, on top of all the abuse, is just making it worse.
Because you abuse yourself.
You abuse yourself.
When you keep it inside.
Exactly. So the point is, we could try and punish the other person, but the hatred is just going to get stronger. So the idea is not to say, this is important because compassion is so misunderstood sometimes. Like holding the other cheek, I don't think it's meant like, come on, abuse me a little bit more.
Yeah.
No, it's an internal state. Stop the person. Punish them if necessary. Like, I'm thinking, I mean, this is what the Dalai Lama talks about, the mother and the child. You care for the child, but you would not allow the child to become a serial killer or do, I mean, even on a less kind of drastic kind of level, but to hurt itself. So you would still stop it through strong means. It's an internal kind of attitude, and this cannot be forced. But one very important thing, and that's what the Dalai Lama mentions in the book over and over, put yourself into the other person's shoes in order to really generate empathy, compassion. And what is compassion? Compassion is defined as a state of mind that wants someone to be happy. The other person and yourself.
Think about the other person, less about yourself, well, but more about the other person.
Try to make it equal, I mean, equally important. My happiness is important, but so is theirs. Usually we have a tendency to consider our own happiness more important, and that causes a lot of trouble. But if we want to generate more love and or compassion for others, the first step is to better understand them, to understand what we have in common, first of all.
We have to make a distinction, that's what I say, because I have one of the keys in my book is called forgiveness.
Okay, yes.
And people misunderstand forgiveness, because how can I forgive this father who abused me? I say that forgiveness, it doesn't mean that you say that what he did was okay. And that you accept it, and that it's okay to do it in the world and to you. It says that at that time, with this state of mind, this is what he did, it's wrong. He shouldn't have done that, he shouldn't have hurt you.
Okay.
But the sorry, when you forgive the other person, you release the anger and the hurt from inside you. It's not for him.
Not for him,
it's for you.
Okay, well, the thing is, like, something the Dalai Lama, it just comes to mind, the Dalai Lama...
But you say the other, you say something more, you say it's also for him.
Right. Well, I repeat something the Dalai Lama said once. He said, you do not forgive the action, you forgive the person.
The person.
Because the action and the person are not the same thing. the person did an action and you shouldn't forgive that, and you should for that action possibly provide punishment, you know, punish the person for his own benefit. I mean, because he could do this to other people, and this person is harming himself possibly more or in the same way as he harms other people. So for the benefit of that person, plus for, of course, your own benefit. So to stop them, but to also try and see where they're coming from. Mm-hmm. Because people who abuse, they usually abuse themselves. So to see what is their state of mind, what is their confusion. Because oftentimes if we put ourselves into their shoe, even though we would never do this, but we can understand a little better what drives them. Because usually it's an uncontrolled kind of urge, and as I said, they've been abused in the past. So it's this kind of circle that they find themselves in. And that's, I think, where the pain kind of can be relieved, because you don't hate the person, you hate the action.
Okay.
And do something about it.
That's a good distinction.
Yeah, I think that's a healthier way, at least, because, yes, the pain of the anger really, I mean, eats you within, from within. But there's also, I mean, a very famous story, I don't know whether I have the time to say that, but it's about the Buddha, before he was a Buddha, when he killed someone who was about to kill a lot of other people. So he killed that person in order to save the other people he was about to kill, but on top of that, to save the person from engaging in it in a very cruel act. So he did it out of compassion, to apply strong measures to stop someone. So again, this idea you should apply strong measures, but on top of that, and judge the action, be unforgiving of that, but try to understand the person.
Okay. אני לא צריך לתרגם את כל מה שהיא אמרה, אבל בגדול מה שהיא והדלאי לאמה אומרים, זה שאנחנו צריכים לחמול את הבן אדם השני, והדרך לעשות זאת זה לשים את עצמנו בנעליים או בעיניים של אותו בן אדם, ואפילו אם הוא עשה מעשה נורא והיום, אני דיברתי על מהספר של אלישה שאבא שלה אנס אותה על גילוי הריות, אפילו מעשה היום של רצח או דברים היום כאלה, אנחנו לא אומרים שהמעשה בסדר. אנחנו לא אומרים לא למעשה, אבל אנחנו חובלים את האדם. זאת הבחנה מאוד מאוד מעניינת בעיניי, וכשאנחנו חומלים את האדם, אנחנו עושים איזשהו תהליך של סליחה. הסליחה היא בעצם עוזרת לנו, לעצמנו, לנקות את הרגשות האלה של הכעס, של הטינה, שאנחנו מחזיקים חזק מאוד בתוכנו. We have just a few more minutes. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you, you know, another question that came from reading the book. Mm-hmm. I can understand compassion.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But there is something else in the book that says no to passion.
Mm.
Now, I have to understand it, because, mm-hmm. you know, as a person who is living in personal development, mm. and who is coaching other people, mm-hmm. I know that passion is a very, very powerful tool, mm-hmm. for changing your life, for putting yourself there, mm-hmm. for daring to do.
Yes, absolutely. You're not talking about passion.
You need passion in life.
Absolutely.
Maybe I misunderstood it.
Yeah, I think the word that's used, and it's a difficult word to use,
because
actually.
Because in Hebrew it says tshuka.
Chuka, yeah. Well, okay. I mean, in English, the word passion is also used. Lust is used more.
Wow.
So it's a problem with the translation, and this is a huge challenge, because even Tibetan, everyday language kind of, and then the more specific Dharma language.
Okay, so it's a matter of translation, you say. It doesn't mean that we should, you know,
it's not a matter of translation, but it's a matter of definition.
Okay.
So like the word desire, for example, or passion, can be used in a positive way or in a negative way. Mm-hmm. Here we're talking about like afflictive, kind of like the sense that I can't be without that. I need that. I would sacrifice anyone else's happiness to get that.
Okay.
Kind of selfish, a passion or lust that is motivated by selfishness. Whereas the one that you describe, wonderful, we need that.
Yeah,
the strength.
It's to get something in order to give,
exactly.
To give it back.
Exactly. So I would totally agree, but to not have that selfish attitude, but to consider everyone else's happiness. My own and others. Do I sacrifice anyone else's?
Okay, okay, good. We made it clear now, because when I read the book, it wasn't so clear to me. You know, I can sit here and talk to you for hours because I love this material and I relate to them. But we have to finish.
Okay.
If people want to hear you here in Israel and to get the book, can you say a little bit about that? How can they meet you? How can they learn from you?
Well, I mean, my trip is at the end, and there's one weekend retreat that I'm offering, and then I'm returning back. I mean, I'm going to Germany and then to India. But there's other people who teach, so the Dharma Friends is there's a
website. קודם כל, את הספר אפשר להשיג פה בארץ דרך אגודת ידידי הדרמה. תקישו ידידי הדרמה, תגיעו לספר, והיא נמצאת פה בארץ בסוף שבוע לעשות רטריט. אפשר גם כן דרך האגודה, through them join the retreat?
Check the Dharma Friend, the website. They have other people like me who come and give talks and so forth. And there's also, you can see how you can buy the book. So check the website, I would recommend.
So Kalseng, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Geshe Kalseng, one more.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming here. Thank you for sharing. תודה לכם שהייתם איתנו. אנחנו נתראה בעוד שבוע עם סיפור מעניין חדש, עם תכנים חדשים, שכולם עוסקים בצמיחה, בהתפתחות שלנו. שיהיה לכולנו חג חנוכה שמח. You know, we have a holiday, Hanukkah, next year. So חג שמח, חג אורים שמח. תהיה לנו תוכנית מיוחדת לחנוכה, לניסים, בשבוע הבא, ואני אשמח שתהיו איתנו. שיהיה לכם המשך יום נהדר. תודה.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thanks.